We're here in Fredericksburg, Virginia, on the site where James Monroe practiced law in the 1780s. And it's here that a museum dedicated to his life and career was established by his family in the 1920s. This site was saved from real estate development by descendants of James Monroe, and utilizing their personal collection of artifacts, plus others that were acquired over the years, they built what is today the largest single collection of artifacts and archives related to our fifth president. James Monroe's career spanned the American Revolutionary era to really the eve of the sectional crisis that would lead to the Civil War. And at every level of government, from local to state to federal, and including diplomatic service, James Monroe was there. We call this gallery The Making of a Revolutionary. And in it, we not only discuss James Monroe's birth and early life, but the influence of the American Revolution on the principles that he would really follow for the rest of his public career. Monroe entered the College of William and Mary as a student, sort of fresh off the farm, really, coming in 1774. Was very caught up in the college community. He became a Mason at this time, was inducted into Freemasonry, receiving an apron that he held on to for the rest of his life, as well as other Masonic items. But it was really the events going on at the beginning of the American Revolution that aroused his patriotic fervor. He took part in a student effort to capture arms that were held in the governor's palace in Williamsburg, and then joined the 3rd Virginia Infantry Regiment, which was part of the Continental Army. And for the next 2 years, Monroe would be in some of the heaviest fighting that George Washington's army would see, mostly in the northern part of the colonies. Monroe stayed with the army through the hard winter of 1777-78 at Valley Forge, and it's that experience that gives us the first public document we've identified with James Monroe's name on it, a furlough that he wrote as an aide-de-camp to General William Alexander, a furlough for a soldier who lived in Pennsylvania and was allowed to go home rather than stay with the Army at Valley Forge. It says Lieutenant Wallace of the 6th Pennsylvania Regiment has Lord Stirling's permission to be absent from the Army 7 weeks. And it's signed James Monroe, aide-de-camp, February 23rd, and we know the year to be 1778. He was 19 years old, already a major, already a seasoned soldier. Even before the American Revolution was over, James Monroe was thinking about the future and what sort of life he could make for himself. He very much wanted to be a prosperous farmer, but was never able to get the land and the resources together to really fully realize that dream. And so, like a lot of young men of his generation with his background, the law seemed a likely alternative. He studied law under Thomas Jefferson, and that really was the beginning of his political career, his entry into the law. It's not just a way of making money, but a way of utilizing contacts that would lead him into government. He served on the Fredericksburg City Council. He served in the Virginia House of Delegates in the United States Congress, was governor of Virginia for 4 terms, and at those levels of government made enormous contacts all over not just Virginia, but the United States. Networking, we'd call it today. I don't think Monroe would have used that term, but he certainly would have understood its contemporary meaning. Because for Monroe, the relationships that he had with his contemporaries were a very real part of who he was and what he did. At the beginning of 1811, Monroe was starting his 4th term as governor of Virginia, but he would not complete that term because he answered the call of his old friend and ally, James Madison, to enter Madison's cabinet as Secretary of State. When the British force landed at Bladensburg, Monroe was there using a telescope in our collection to count the number of ships and the amount of materiel and the numbers of troops that were being disembarked, using a series of riders to send that information back to James Madison. When the British Army got to Bladensburg and the battle that was fought there against mostly light militia forces, Monroe, along with President Madison and most of the rest of the cabinet, was on the field. James Madison was the first president to come under fire from an enemy force. The next one would be Abraham Lincoln during the Civil War. Madison made a gift to Monroe after the war, a set of dueling pistols. They had been given to Madison earlier by the nation of Argentina as an official gift, but Madison later bestowed them upon Monroe, perhaps in gratitude for their lifelong friendship and particularly for the threat that they had faced at Bladensburg in 1814. But with the final signing of the peace treaty and the end of the war, he could turn his attention back to domestic politics and his own election to the presidency in 1816. National unity, a strong defense, and foreign policy were among the major elements of Monroe's presidency. He came into office at a time of realignment with the political situation in the United States, the Federalist Party somewhat fading, the Republican Party, the Democratic Republican Party, certainly on the rise. And Monroe sought to have a harmonious administration. It would be called the era of good feelings. He undertook tours around the northern and southern regions of the country while president to literally show the American people their chief executive, and he was well received on all of these. He promoted a strong national defense, arming against future threats from other nations in this hemisphere particularly, and on the high seas. But the idea of European intervention also dictated foreign policy, and Monroe would be particularly concerned about France and Britain and Russia attempting to influence the events in South America or through Canada. The Monroe Doctrine, which was enunciated in his annual message to Congress in 1823, was a statement to the European powers that their intervention in the affairs of the Western Hemisphere would not be tolerated by the United States, and that the United States would stay out of any entangling foreign alliances of its own with the powers of Europe. And this really became a cornerstone of American foreign policy well into the 20th century, used and abused by various successive presidents for different circumstances, but still one of the longest lasting presidential policies to still have a viable impact on affairs long after that presidency was over. And within the museum, we have one of our principal artifacts, probably the star artifact, the desk that Monroe, according to family tradition, composed the Monroe Doctrine on, this annual message to Congress. It is part of the suite of furniture the Monroes purchased back in the 1790s in their first posting to France. It is part of the furniture that was in just about every private and official residence the Monroes would occupy, including the White House. This piece and many others descended through the family to finally Lawrence Gouverneur Hughes, the great-great-grandson of James Monroe, who as a child, it is said, liked to climb up on this desk and jump off. During one of those occasions in the very early 20th century, it fell over on him. And although young Lawrence was not injured, the desk had to be repaired, but it was an interesting happenstance because in the process of being repaired, this desk yielded up a secret compartment that contained a large cache of letters between Monroe and people like Benjamin Franklin, Thomas Jefferson, James Madison. So whether it's a true story or not, it is a wonderful illustration of how the Monroe family and all of its descendant branches helped preserve this legacy and helped make the James Monroe Museum possible. Throughout a long and distinguished career, James Monroe epitomized selfless public service. The museum that bears his name, which is proudly administered by the University of Mary Washington, seeks to interpret that legacy, and we hope inspire our visitors to understand a little more about the early American Republic and about a remarkable individual, James Monroe.